Welcome, everyone. A very warm welcome to each and every one of you as we gather in friendship and in faith. I'm the Reverend Barbara Clark, a minister in the United Church of Canada. I'm in ministry with the folks at the Ilderton United Church in Ontario. We began these online worship services a couple of months ago as a way to keep in touch with each other while our church buildings are closed during the pandemic. The idea being that even if we were socially distant, we were with each other in spirit. And now, even though some places are slowly returning to in-person sales and services, most churches are going to continue to gather in this way until it's safer to gather in person. So even though we're missing each other, I know I am missing you. Worshiping online is still the best way to look after each other. And so it is in the spirit of Jesus Christ that we gather in this online community. Wherever you are, whoever you are, let us celebrate God's presence together. May this candle remind us of the light of Christ that cannot be overcome, and may this light shine brightly in all of your lives. Well, I really miss singing as part of a congregation and a choir. I've been trying to acknowledge that disappointment as a way to respect the toll that it's taken on those of us who share this disappointment, this kind of grief. So I've got three hymns today for our worship time. This first one is one of the oldest in our hymnary, Praise to the Lord, the Almighty. Let's lift our hearts with praise as we sing together. This week that the Ilderton Fair has been canceled this year. For those of you who don't know, the Ilderton Fair is a fall fair that celebrates rural life, agriculture, and community. I'm glad to hear there are some projects in the works to help keep the spirit of the Ilderton Fair alive. As you know, ours is not the only community to make this kind of difficult decision. And this decision, or maybe it's a different decision to cancel or postpone something else, might be on your mind today. I don't know if you're like me. I'm finding these disappointments are accumulating. So my invitation to us all in this time of centering prayer is to slow down and to offer to God those things that weigh on our hearts in this moment. Let us pray. O God, we offer our sadnesses to you today. It's been a long time without some of the vital things that feed our spirits. Church worship and fellowship, family gatherings, birthday parties and anniversary celebrations. Graduations have been postponed, weddings have been postponed, and funerals cannot be fully observed without the presence of all the family and friends. This week it was confirmed that children will have to wait many months to return to school, that summer sleepaway camps have to change the way they operate this summer, that the Ilderton Fair and the format we know and love has been canceled this year. Some days, life in this pandemic time is just plain hard. But as we think of the things that we are sad about, we offer each one of those things to you, O God. For you help us carry the things we have trouble carrying ourselves. We know that these decisions are ultimately for the health of us all. And so, Holy One, we pray for your encouragement and grace in these times, knowing that you hear our prayers and answer in love. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I've chosen one of the lectionary readings for Ascension Sunday. This is from the Gospel of Luke. Heather Mastromattei is our reader today. May God's word speak to us now through this reading.
Today's reading is from Luke 24, verses 44 to 53, from the Common English Bible. Jesus said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law from Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. He said to them, "This is what is written, the Christ will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and a change of heart and life for the forgiveness of sins must be preached in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witness to these things. Look, I'm sending to you what my father promised, but you are to stay in the city until you have been furnished with heavenly power." He led them out as far as Bethany, where he lifted his hands and blessed them. As he blessed them, he left them and was taken up to heaven. They worshipped him and returned to Jerusalem, overwhelmed with joy, and they were continuously in the temple praising God. This ends the reading.
So that's part of the Ascension story. That's a lot to cover in a 4-minute meditation. So let's start with this. This is the traditional interpretation of Jesus' ascension. He's been with the disciples in the 40 days since Easter, showing them that death does not have the final word and encouraging them to continue his ministry when he is finally physically absent from the world. So in this passage, he tells them to wait for the heavenly power, which is the Holy Spirit, and then to go to the world to continue his mission. So the disciples wait, and Jesus ascends to heaven, and in that way, Jesus the Christ can be with everyone, everywhere, always. So that's the traditional interpretation of the ascension for the people of Christ. In some ways, this event is so unbelievable that it loses its liveliness in the retelling and in the interpreting. But let's focus on one thing today. For the disciples, there is a bit of a gap between Jesus' physical departure up to heaven and the arrival of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost that will send them out into the world. Does this gap feel at all familiar to you? It does to me. The gap I'm experiencing right now is the gap between how I lived my life before the pandemic and how I intend to return to it all when it's safe to return to the world. I'm in this gap, uncertain of how long it will last, uncertain about what the return to the new normal will look like, and maybe even feeling a little bit frozen here in this gap. A lot uncertain and a little bit frozen. Well, maybe you feel that way too. I offer that the gift of this retelling for us is that after Jesus blessed the disciples and then ascended and before the Holy Spirit arrived, that was their gap. And they didn't know how long they would have to wait until the Holy Spirit would arrive. And, you know, they might have responded by feeling a little bit frozen and a lot uncertain. But our faith story tells us that during their gap, they worshiped God and returned to Jerusalem overwhelmed with joy. And then they were continuously praising God in the temple. That blessing that Jesus gave them just before he ascended must have been some blessing. It really stuck. The thing that I believe really stuck and stayed with them actually is a new experience of Jesus' presence. Before he ascended, he was with them even after the resurrection, still teaching, guiding, healing, and loving. And now it's more like the teaching, guiding, healing, and loving of Christ are within them. The gap they're in is full of life and love. The same is for us. This gap that we're in is not empty. This in-between time gap when we're spending so much, if not all of our time at home, this time is full too. For example, social distancing itself is one way that we show our love for God's world and our neighbors and the people working in healthcare. We're not empty. This is a form of social engagement. Worship, prayer, singing, even at home like this, this is a form of social engagement. If your prayer is how to find the faithful path in the year 2020, or asking how to fulfill Christ's mission, asking what does that even look like nowadays, then this is social engagement. The gap is not empty. If your prayers are for others, the gap is not empty. The gap is full of life and love. Letters, petitions, and donations are ways to speak on behalf of someone whose voice has been silenced or marginalized, and to speak on behalf of the health of the earth. Prayer, advocacy, electing good leaders, these are things we can do in the gap. The gap that is full of life and love. This week there have been many disappointments. So let the faith of those first disciples inspire you. The gap was full of life and love, and they were continually praising God. Actually, I believe there is always a continual praise of God in the universe. Somewhere, someone is always praising God. So in the moments when you feel disappointment or grief, or even disconnected from God's presence, the continual praise of God carries on until you're ready to join again. And sometimes it's the very action of worship, of praising God, where we tell our faith story, sing our songs of faith, and say our prayers of faith, the very action of worship reconnects us to this Christ that is all in all. The moderator of our church, the Right Reverend Richard Bott, wrote a prayer poem this week that ends with these words. Even with my tears, even with my frustrations, even with my fears, I sing my songs of hope in your goodness. I hum my hymns in celebration of your wonder. I dance my dances in praise of your love. And may it ever be so. We're going to sing again. Jesus left them with a blessing, left the disciples with a blessing, and then he rose to the heavens. This week, I picture our spirits rising with him, rising up to the potential of our fullest and best selves. I'm going to let the music speak to this. Rise up, O my soul. Please pray with me once again. God of love and infinite compassion, you blessed the first disciples with the vision of new heaven and new earth, and so you bless us. With grateful hearts, we give you thanks and strengthen our resolve to seek justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with you every day. These days are challenging for so many. We take this time to hold in the light of your love, our concern for others and our own fears. Today we pray for the well-being of our children. We continue to express our gratitude for people in healthcare and emergency services. And at the same time, we pray for their well-being. We pray for people waiting for surgeries and treatments. We ask you to bless the farmers whose work never ends, and who continue to feed us all. For all these, we lift our prayers and give thanks that you answer in love. In this quiet moment now, we name for you the people we hold in our hearts and minds this day. For all these, we lift our prayers and give thanks that you answer in love. Holy One, grant us grace to trust your loving ways and purposes. All of our prayers we lift to you as we pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. So let's sing once again. This is a video of the song, What Does the Lord Require of You? It's recorded by the hymn writers themselves, Jim and Jean Strathdee. I met them both at London Conference annual meeting a few years ago when they were leading the conference in song. Jim and Jean recorded this just this last month so that it could be used by churches offering worship online during the pandemic. It's good to see them again, even if it's in a video. So let's sing this together. Let's sing this with Jim and Jean. What does the Lord require of you?
Hello, friends. We're going to sing What Does the Lord Require of You? This is a setting of Micah 6:8 from the Hebrew Scriptures. It's a song designed for three parts. So we're going to divide the room into three sections. Section 1, Section 2, and Section 3. Now, sometimes people like to sing, who have low voices, like to sing the first part. And people with middle voices would sing the second. And people with higher voices, along with children, can sing the third. We're going to do each part two times, and then we'll start at the beginning, adding each voice in. And it will be beautiful if you sing out boldly. So here we go.
What does the Lord require of you? What does the Lord require of you? What does the Lord require of you? What does the Lord require of you?
To the rest of your day. May God be your comfort, your strength. May God be your hope and your support. May God be your light and your way. And the blessing of God, Creator, Redeemer, and Giver of life, remain with you now and always. Amen.